I wanted to ask you this.
Yeah.
But before we get to that question, I'm going to ask you about the afterlife in a little while.
Mm.
But so I can keep it on track. And this isn't for shock and awe. Mm. This is so people can appreciate what men like you do for a living yeah. and how important you are. Even if it's just one or two shockingly sad memories or just or graphic, like the worst scene that you've attended to and yeah. had to deal with. This is yeah. this is your life.
I know it. I can tell you it. So I remember attending an RTA. And there was two young kids that had been killed, a girl of 19, a boy of 23. And they'd been to a wedding, a friend's wedding. And the way it worked is they were in a little Ford KA and they'd gone up the dual carriageway. And it's a particularly long stretch. It's like a 5 mile stretch. It's unlit and it was pitch black. And this pisshead in a brand new Merc had gone down one of the exits off the roundabout and down the dual carriageway and hit a med on and killed them both. And I remember seeing the two splash marks on the, what was left of the screen of the KA, and all he had was just a sprained wrist. And the cop said he was actually quite blasé. It was the third time he'd been caught drink driving. And yeah, yeah. Do you know when you're just like, and to see, I never forget, because the young boy, he had his collarbone had come through his shirt and it was bright white and it was shining, glistening in the light and the smell of fresh lamb and piss. And only an undertaker or someone on the coroner's crew will understand that. And two little body bags sitting there with crumpled bits in and a bridesmaid's dress covered in claret. And just not nice. And going home and not being able to sleep that night and closing your eyes and you can just see it. And it took me a few nights to be able to sleep and not think about it. Mm. But, you know, inevitably you get on and you, onwards and upwards. But, yeah, that particularly one was quite shaken, and even now, you know, how do you ever get over that as a family? The anger, you know, the wanting to murder that man for what he'd done, because it was murder. It weren't the first time. And I'll never forget the number plate. It spelled out the word Wilson. So we obviously had plenty of money. It was W1LSO, but it spelt the name Wilson in letters and words. Yeah, so we obviously had money. And just being sickened at how selfish and wicked people can be, you know.
I bet it's made you view the world very differently.
Yeah, yeah, it makes you realise how fragile life is, and it disappoints me how little people care for other people. You know, people in this industry, anyone can walk in front of a nurse, anyone can wear an hat, you know, the same as you get two different guys plumb an house for someone, you know, two plumbers. I was always told, you know, Do a job in someone else's house like you would for yours. If I borrowed your motor, I'd take better care of it than I would if it was mine. Because that's just the way I am. That's the way I am. So if I look after someone's mum, I'll knock on the door when they're in the chapel of rest before I go in there. There's no one in there. There's only me there. Mm. But I still knock on that door. Because if I take liberties with people and I pass, there'd be lots of angry people waiting for me. Now, when I go, I can tell you now, they're going to be very happy to see me. And they'll thank me for what I've done, because I'm like that behind closed doors.
You know, when you turn up to a suicide, for example. You know,
I don't do suicides anymore. When I worked for the coroner, I did 7 years where suicide would be a sudden death, would be a coroner's. So I don't do coroners anymore, but I have many of them, yeah.
But you, so, okay, so when you have attended a suicide
yeah.
and you're dealing with a family, is there a common denominator? Is there like a predominant reason why a lot of people take their life, be it divorce?
Yeah. As regards the reasons for death, money, marital breakups, predominantly young men under 50, and all manner of bizarre ones. I remember one guy, he killed himself with a plastic bag and a gas canister of helium in an hotel room. I remember another guy who lit a barbecue in the back of a car and just sat down with a bottle of whiskey, and that nailed him. Another bloke shot his face off. All manner of different things. And I kind of, what made me think about it the most was wondering how bad the pain, whatever that be, must have been for them to do that. And did they think that the pain would end by killing themselves? Because it don't. All it does is it offloads it onto the people that you love the most. Suicide, that's what suicide does. It don't end the pain. It transfers it from you to all the people that love you the most that have to deal with that. So, you know, I would say to anyone, please don't ever consider doing that without at least reaching out. And Milton Keynes Family Funeral Services, you can call me 24/7 before you take your life and I'll give you a reason to carry on. And I've been there and I've watched the pain and agony on the next of kin, on the Knox next of kin, when they've been on the scene. And it don't end the pain. You give it to the people that love you the most. I think the trouble is blokes are not particularly good. You know, in this masculine image, blokes are not good at crying. And they're not good at talking, and nobody wants to reach out and say, I've got a problem, I've got a real anger, I feel this low. And, do you know, it's the mark of a real man that you can. I've cried. I've had times in my life when I felt about ending it. We all have, if we're honest, you know, whether it be at 19 because of the breakup of a girl or because you're in debt or whether it be drugs, you know. Don't kid yourself that just because you think you're big and hard, you've never thought about taking. Like, everybody has at some point. I ain't saying they've ever seriously thought about it, but it's something that's crossed most people's mind. But I would say, if ever you really feel that low, guys, please do reach out to someone, because there is someone that gives a fuck. You know, you can ring my number, I'll pick up. If my phone rings, I'll pick that up 24/7. And I've had loads of people ring me up who've talked about, since I've been speaking out, who've said, you've saved me. You've saved people that I've never even met. It's better to give than to receive. And do you know what? You hang up the phone. I had a guy called Jason. He's going to know who he is. He said, you've saved me, talking me through this darkness. And I'll spend an hour on the phone to the guy because I know it makes a difference. And I know this guy's now got a more positive outlook, and he's got a child and he's got a missus, and you know, they're never, ever going to know. And I don't care. I don't want no accolade. It feels better to give than to receive. Just caring about other people.
I think it also pays to be prepared. And I say this quite often. And I'm acutely aware that I'm going to have yet another phone call that's going to change my life forever.
Yeah, of course.
And I think if you can, don't be naive to the fact that you could be on top of the world today and it takes one phone call and you're rock bottom and you're absolutely blitzed.
Yeah.
And you have to be mindful that that is going to happen 100%. And you need to be prepared for the rebuild.
Yeah. I think especially after what's happened in the last few years and what people have got floating about in them, without a doubt. And that people say to me quite often, I could never do your job. Do you know what? I could never do anything else. And how do you cope with it? Do you know why? Because I go home and I think, what a fucking good day I've had compared to that person that I dealt with today, compared to that person that I dealt with yesterday who lost her kids, you know? And yeah, you got to put a positive spin on it. I've had a good day today, mate. Do you know, what have I done? I went and done a funeral this morning. I had a cup of tea with my missus. I said to her, I've come down, I've kept company here.
And I suppose that could go either way. You could either think, I'm grateful to be here, or you could think, I'm going to be gone soon like this person.
Yeah. It's wherever you want to put, is it half full or is it half empty?
It's good you channel it that way.
Yeah, of course you have to, because otherwise you wouldn't survive. You wouldn't be able to do it. You wouldn't be able to do the coroners if you picked up pieces. I can remember, do you know the amount of training I had for the coroners was that he gave me a mobile phone and they gave me a van. That was it. And I'd only ever picked up people from the hospital in one piece and a body bag and slide them over in a tray, check the wristlet, exchange pleasantries, and off you go. I was picking up people out the road with coffin plates, picking their brains up. Yeah, where the copper would say to me, he'd come over and he'd say, right, I want every bit bigger than an inch picking up. And I'd never done that before. They didn't give us any kit. I had no needle-proof boots. Fuck all. So I kind of had to learn and I had to teach myself as I went. If you go to a fifth floor of a block of flats and there's a junkie laying wrapped around the toilet, how do you get that person out? That's not something I'd ever done. I had to train myself. So I've done all of that. You know, a 42 stone person, how do you get them out? And do it with some sort of dignity. There's ways to do it, and there's equipment and there's knowledge and there's also empathy, compassion, and how you engage with that family. Do you know, some families are, they, you can see it in them when you go to the house. You know, so look, I'm going to take mum now. We've got a little bit of stretcher that we use, and this is why we use it. And I'm not going to pick your mum up by the ankles. I'm going to roll her. I'm going to pop a sheet under her. Then we're going to hammock her and lift her over nice and gentle, like I want my mum doing. And it's the way you engage with people and deal with people. And it is a skill and it's a template you acquire, but it's based on actually just caring with people. If you care for people, you want to perfect it and you want to polish it. And don't get me wrong, in early days, I probably came back and I thought, what would I have done different there? And I'm my own fiercest critic. Well, I'd do that different and I perhaps wouldn't have said that. And simple things like if you go to a family on the day of a funeral and say, good morning, it ain't a fucking good morning, mate. It's not a good, you go, morning, because it ain't a good morning.
Yeah.
You know, and you'll get one in every 100 that would take great offence because they're amplified, because they're grieving. you know, so it's just little bits, and you polish your template over time.